This, what we're going to do today is a review for some of you, and hopefully it'll be something that can bless your soul, even a little harder than your first. It's a little bit Sanctuary 101, and for those of you that have studied the sanctuary a lot, bear with us. There's so much to study. It's like this onion that has adding layers of skin. And for those of us that have studied it, or haven't studied it, I'm just hoping that you'll get a desire to study a little more. Well, we're going old school this morning. Ray is going to show us what we have if the lights go out. We still have these beautiful paintings, and they're from the Review and Herald. I'm sorry, I don't know the original painter, but I remember the gal who painted it for our evangelistic team. Her last name is Shakespeare. What do we have in front of us? The sermon title is Living the Sanctuary. How many have ever heard about praying through the sanctuary? Is that anything you've ever heard about praying through the sanctuary? And all the pieces of the furniture in the sanctuary mean so much and have such deep meanings. But this morning, by God's grace, I'm going to take us through some important things that were in my mind, and hopefully they'll be a blessing to you. Shall we bow our heads one more time? Our God in heaven, by the power of the name of Jesus Christ that you sent for us, I want to praise you and thank you for your word. Your word is a rock. It doesn't change, and it's eternal, and you are a living word speaking to us through the power of your Holy Spirit in our hearts. May you speak to us today. May we hear, may we understand, may we believe, and may we go forth in doing what you have taught us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to thank our special music. Amy, that was gorgeous. Just gorgeous. And the words to that, you know, he died, he paid our debt, he died our debt that we might live. Amen. Do we deserve any of that? Do we know how the sanctuary teaches us? We're probably going to have to lose those lights in the front. How the sanctuary teaches us the transference of sin, that our guiltiness can be taken from us and put someplace else. And that is one of the big lessons from the sanctuary, that God prepared the hearts of his people so that when he sent his son, that they would be able to understand and accept that God had a plan to transfer the guiltiness of our sin from us onto the sacrifice, the living sacrifice. What we see here is that great big lampstand, Gilbert. This is the one I was going to show you. The lampstand, the table of showbread, the altar of incense, which is associated with the most holy place because the smoke goes up. And as it goes by the beautiful Ark of the Covenant with the two covering angels and the high priest would go in there. We have so much to cover. I'm going to just give you another little picture here, those of you that can read this. It's interesting that the Ark of the Covenant, that the tabernacle actually had the right side facing north as you walked in. The back, the most holy place, was toward the west. So as a person came into this tabernacle, they would be turning their back on the east, the greatest place of where sun worship would take place. In Jesus in the sanctuary, you have the judgment. That's the last part. This is sort of like a timeline, if you will, and Carl in the Sabbath School was talking about it. As Jesus' sacrifice is on the burnt altar and the labor, and then his ministry of intercession in the holy place, and then his ministry of judgment in the most holy place on the Day of Atonement. Overcomers. In Revelation 14, verse 12, This is one of the verses that we're going to take with us through most of this teaching. And here is the patience of the saints. Would you read it with me, everyone out loud? Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So it's a combo. The patience of the saints can also be called the endurance of the saints, because we know that the saints themselves will suffer persecution and have suffered persecution. And before Revelation 14, here it is in Revelation 12, verse 17. Read this one with me also, please.
And the dragon was enraged with the woman, and he went to make war with the rest of her offspring, who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ.
So one part says the faith of Jesus, and one part says the testimony of Jesus Christ. And I was curious, where do we find the commandments of God? If this is the people in the end of time that are going to be persecuted by the dragon, where do we find the commandments of God? Where do we find the testimony of Jesus? And so I remember that the Ark of the Testimony is a word that's used frequently. So in Exodus 25, 22, it says, there I will meet with you from above the mercy seat. And over here in our painting, some of you can't see it, there's a beautiful picture of the mercy seat and the glory, the Shekinah glory of God. And he says, there I will meet with you, and from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubim, which are upon the, everybody read that with me, the Ark of the Testimony, I will speak to you about all that I will give you in command for the sons of Israel. And that's in Exodus. In Numbers, it says, when they were carrying things out, Aaron and his sons shall go in, and they shall take down the veil of the screen and cover the Ark of Testimony with it. In Joshua, he was commanded, the Lord spoke unto Joshua, saying, command the priests that bear the Ark of the Testimony that they come up out of Jordan. So this ark, this place where God would speak from, was the Ark of the Testimony. We're going to look quickly at some of the sacrifices. There was the continual burnt offering, and this is not extensive, it's not complete. But the continual burnt offering, there was a presentation of the offering, the pouring out of the blood, the burning on the altar, and the sacrificial meal in the case of the peace offering only, the fat having been burned, the priest's pieces removed from the rest of the flesh was eaten by the sacrificer, his household, and the poorer Levites at the tabernacle. So there were sacrifices that were made at the tabernacle. There was the peace offering. There was the burnt offering. And the burnt offering got its Hebrew name from the idea of the smoke of the sacrifice ascending to heaven. The characteristic rite was the burning of the whole animal on the altar. So it would be a male without blemish, and then of his own voluntary will, it served as a free expression of gratitude by the individual, the blood around the altar, and then they would flay it open, cut it into his piece, and burn all on the altar. This sacrifice was performed at the tabernacle, later at the temple in Jerusalem, every morning and evening, as well as on special occasions. Like I said, this is not everything that we can study about the sanctuary. This is just little pieces that we're putting together. But the Hebrew word for testimony was edut, and I can't pronounce Hebrew. I haven't studied it. But the Ark of the Testimony. Look at all these places where it's found. Ark of the Testimony. The tabernacle of the congregation, the Ark of the Testimony, and the mercy seat that's on it, and all the furniture of the tabernacle. Exodus 31, 18. He gave to Moses, when he had made an end of communing with him upon the Mount Sinai, two tablets of testimony, tablets of stone written with the finger of God. And Moses turned and went down from the mount, in chapter 32, verse 15. And the two tablets of the testimony were in his hand. The tablets were written on both their sides. On the one side and on the other were they written. And the tablets were the work of God, and the writing was the writing of God engraved upon the tablets. Exodus 34, verse 29. And it came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of testimony in Moses' hand when he came down from the mount, that Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone while he talked with him. Exodus 38, verse 21. This is the sum of the tabernacle and of the tabernacle of testimony. So now the concept of testimony is expanded not just from the ark, not just from, but to the tablets, and now to the tabernacle of testimony, as it was counted according to the commandment of Moses for the service of the Levites by the hand of Ithamar, son of Aaron, the priest. Chapter 39 through 35, the ark of the testimony and its staves and the mercy seat. Again, throughout the scriptures there, it is called the ark of the testimony. Where do we find the commandments of God? And where do we find the testimony of Jesus? It's found there in the book of Revelation. They're talking to us about the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus. And the Old Testament talks about the ark of his testimony. So let's find out some more about what this beautiful scripture is talking about. Our scripture reading today was from Hebrews chapter 9. And we read there, and Paul in his, well, we believe that Paul is probably the author of Hebrews, he said, of which things we cannot now speak. And so today we're going to speak a little bit about those things that he didn't have time to write about. And one of the things that he didn't have time to write about was just about the tabernacle, but it's in chapter 9 and verse 2. I'm hoping that you will find yourself wanting to read chapters 8, 9, and 10 when you get a chance to. I mean, it's Sabbath all day long, and hopefully we find time for the Word as well as other activities. For a tabernacle was prepared, and this is actually a place that they set up in the wilderness. That video is from BiblePlaces.com, or that still is from BiblePlaces.com if you ever desire to go there. And the first part in which was the lampstand, the table, and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary. And here on the platform, we have the lampstand, the table of the showbread, and the, the other part, which is the altar of incense. But the first two parts have to do with Jesus's intercession for us. It's funny because if you look at that painting too carefully, you'll see a small error, but I don't want you to focus on that the whole time. In the screen, we talked about that oil that flowed through the lampstand that represented the Holy Spirit. And this was a very tall thing that or tall enough to provide light. And don't forget that the sides of the inside of the holy place, these boards were covered with gold that was beaten like aluminum foil. You know, if we had tin foil, it'd be like that thin, and they wrapped around these boards, and so just a little bit of light would really reflect off the gold. Gold doesn't tarnish the way silver might, and God put the gold inside. This is the table of showbread. There's one artist's rendition of it, and this is the bread that was on there, and that was changed once a week. And remember that 7 days without prayer makes 1 week. And the bread that God has given us is the bread of life. And Jesus said that no man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And then in Hebrews 9, behind the second veil, the part of the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all. And so here's an artist's rendition of that veil. We know that there were cherubim that were embroidered on it, and it had beautiful colors, the royal colors. And that veil, like I said in the other picture, the smoke of the incense was like intercession of the prayers of the priests that rose up and went over the top and into the presence of God, which had the golden censer. And here's an artist's rendition of the golden censer. Notice that at the top of these horns, there's blood on the tips of those horns. The guiltiness was transferred, and we'll look at that in some other illustrations. But this will be the altar of incense, and those post staves or poles were so that the priest and those that carried it could transfer it, and without touching any of the holy things. And the Ark of the Covenant overlaid on all sides with gold, and I regret that only half the people can see this beautiful painting of the Ark. But we have another one here. Can you imagine overlaid all with gold, how beautiful that is? And the angels touching. Now, we know in heaven there were covering angels, because this, as we'll see, is all on the earth, but it was because God was showing this to Moses in from heaven. Then inside the Ark of the Covenant, which were the golden pot that had manna, Aaron's rod that budded, and the tablets of the covenant. So this is inside the Ark of the Testimony. This is inside. Aaron's rod that budded was about the fact that somebody wanted to usurp authority over God's appointed authority. The manna provides a thought that God provided for all of his children in every situation. Give us this day our daily bread, and they received it daily. Except for, interestingly enough, they got double portion on Sabbath, on preparation day, and it didn't rain manna on the Sabbath day, but it never did bread worms either, like it did if you had tried to keep it on the other day. So there was a witness of God's faithfulness that he would take care of us, and he always has. He is our nourishment. So there's another place where, if you were looking at the side, you would see the Ark of the Testimony. I'm asking ourselves, where do we find the commandments of God, and where do we find the testimony of Jesus? And above it was the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat. And I like this rendition, because even though you can't see it, there's the manna, the tablets of the testimony, and the Ark, or the rod of Aaron that budded. And this wonderful idea of the presence of God. If you come to church and you don't feel the presence of God, you should know that he is here, and that by faith we can access his presence. We access his presence through the word. We access his presence through praising him. We access his presence by knowing and believing in faith that he wants us to know that we are in his presence. And so his presence was shielded, though, because it's so powerful, it was behind the veil, and only, no man can look at God and live, and that was the way he had his presence there. Notice that this priest is there, and we have the laver, and these animals that were going to be sacrificed and burnt on some of them, you know, basically there's a lot of cooking going on. The laver had the laver and its foot. And there are some, when I researched this before, there are some who think that perhaps the water in the top basin had little spigots that they could turn on and have running water, so that it would be running water, is much more clean. And then the foot would catch some of the water that ran down. But they washed their feet. They knew that they had to be clean to come into the presence of God in his holy place. And that was part of it, the laver. There's many significances to the laver. We would say that we are cleansed by the washing of the water of the word. We know that when we are baptized, we are submerged in water. And when you're in water, you can't breathe. And when you come up, you grab a big breath of water, and you're renewed to newness of life. And so even the laver suggests the resurrection from the dead and the resurrection of new life. But the cleansing of the water from the bloody hands of the priests who were offering the sacrifices. And that there was a fire here at the altar of burnt offering. And that also was able to be carried when they were traveling through the wilderness. Here's an artist's rendition, but this is actually a physical place. I think this is the BiblePlaces.com also. And there's their labor, but this is where their altar of burnt offering was. And some people make the tabernacle square across the top. Some make it so it comes down in different ways. But this actually exists up in a desert area. Notice then, And for coming to Christ, we come through the slain Lamb of God. We are baptized in obedience to his command. We know that he calls us to be the light of the world, and the Holy Spirit is going to flow through us and grant us that light. We know that without the bread of life, the word of God, daily, we have no nourishment, and we can't become or live like the children of God. Jesus is constantly making the prayers of intercession for us that are ascending into his holy place. He has moved into the holy place, but this is not the subject of our discussion today. This would have been the place where the Ark of the Testimony was, and the presence of God would be there. Now, the artist that is in this next picture showed me that it's like a cross, and the way to God and fellowship with God in his intercession, and then ultimately the Day of Atonement. We'll speak a little bit about that, how it is a day of judgment. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11 to 12, it says, "But when Christ appeared as high priest of the good things to come, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle not made with hands, that is to say, not of this creation, and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood, he entered the holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption." So praise God for that. Amen. This one, I want you to read this with me. This is what John the Baptist said when he saw Jesus coming to be baptized. And it's recorded in John chapter 1, verse 29. I think it says, everyone, let's read it together.
"Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world."
We know who that Lamb is. That Lamb is our, as he is the sacrifice, and he is the high priest, and he is our soon coming king. When a person sinned in ancient Israel, what was he to bring to the sanctuary? If you want to find it, it's in Leviticus 5, verse 6, and he was to bring a lamb. And the fulfillment of the sanctuary, how did Moses design the tabernacle? Well, and that one was in Exodus 25, verse 9 and 40. God told him, "Make them according to the pattern which was shown you on the mountain." So God showed a pattern to Moses when he was on the mountain, and that pattern is what he said to go ahead and make when it was time to build this thing, this actual thing that they would be able to see. And of what was the Mosaic sanctuary a pattern? Well, the copy and shadow of the heavenly things. Have you ever thought about an architectural design being just like a plans? My dad was a contractor, and he brought home architectural plans all the time. You lay down the plans, you look at those plans, and you don't know what the building looks like unless you've really got a good imagination. But the plans are just the plans. So when God made this thing on earth, it doesn't mean that that's exactly what it looked like in heaven, because there's thousands and thousands of angels that minister to the Lord in heaven. So we get this little mini model that teaches us, but don't think that God's confined to only a little mini model. The model is accurate. It is a pattern of heavenly things, not to take that away. But the glory of heaven is so much bigger than we can even imagine. Thousands and thousands and thousands of angels ministering to the Lord all the time. This is a fantastic, wonderful place. Now, if you're trying to just shake yourself a little bit, I know this kind of stuff is dry, and I want you to stay awake, so I should have had everybody stand up and sit down at some point. But the copy and shadow of the heavenly things. So whatever we have here is miniature and accurate. But don't forget how glorious the heavens are. You know, Ezekiel shows us about the heavens, and when we studied the sanctuary in Sabbath school a couple years ago, I remember how beautiful that was to see. Here's a high priest, which is the high priest, which the stones that are on his breastplate, 12 stones that are to remind the high priest that he was representing the 12 tribes of Israel, the people of God. But who's our high priest today? Christ. Christ is our high priest, and he carries us on his heart and in intercession for us, and he wants so much for us to want him as much as he wants us. How many sanctuaries are there in Scripture? In Hebrews 8, verse 15, my Bible says, nope, there's no Hebrews 8, verse 15, so that's wrong. I think I was supposed to do Hebrews 8, 1 through 5. Forgive me for losing that. Now, this is the main point of the things we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens, minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord erected and not man, which the Lord pitched and not man. That tells us that there's something that we, that's bigger than what we can imagine. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifice, where it is of a necessity that this man, referring to Jesus, has something also to offer. For if he was on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who serve as an example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, self he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount. So Jesus is a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord erected and not man. You think about how different this little tabernacle that was able to be portable was compared to the artist's rendition of what it might have been like if you went into Solomon's tabernacle, Solomon's temple. Now take Solomon's temple, and we get excited about big buildings. I don't know about you, but even when I see like a Lincoln Memorial, I go, whoa, look at the size of those pillars. Nothing compared to what God's doing in the heavens. And yet, he's given us a glimpse of this amazing, amazing picture of what he is doing. So who is the high priest of the sanctuary, of the heavenly sanctuary? And that would be in Hebrews chapter 4. And verse 14, is that what it said? Yeah. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. And for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. And this is one of my favorite verses. Next, verse 16. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We have a high priest in heaven, friends, and he is willing to not only make intercession for us, but to provide cleansing for us. Well, how many mediators are there between God and people in the New Testament times? Well, there's one God and one mediator between God and men, and that's the man Christ Jesus. You know, Jesus fulfills the sanctuary service. That's so important for us to understand that, that those things, they were a type, but they were not the real deal. What we needed was what Christ would do. And Ricky, you brought it out so well in Sabbath school this morning that God had a predicament, because the Bible says that nobody else can die for somebody else's sins. So Jesus had to become us so he could die as us, for us. And that is the way that God solved this problem. Now here's a question. What phase of Christ's ministry is symbolized by the work of the altar of burnt offering? I'm sorry, Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 26. Chapter 9 and verse 26, if you're using your Bible. Which I always encourage, even though there's things on the screen. 9 and 26 says this, he then would have had to suffer often since the foundation of the world, but now, once at the end of the ages, he has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. By the sacrifice of himself. So what phase of Christ's ministry is symbolized by the work of the altar burnt offering? The sacrifice of himself. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. That's to help you. in, has not entered the holy places made with hands, but is the heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. How amazing. He's appearing in the presence of God for us. He's making intercession for us. You know, how many of us neglect praying for things that God could do for us if we would just ask Him? You know, when